Hi, college. Today we're going to talk about reducing compound intervals to their simple equivalent form. We will identify intervals as either simple or compound. We will identify the specific name for both simple and compound intervals. And then we will construct and notate simple interval equivalents. So, let's begin. First, we need to review. For each question here, write harmonic intervals above and below each note to form the requested intervals. When you get done with that, you can look down below and try to find out which intervals below are tritones, and also identify the name and quality for each melodic interval from number to number. So take a few moments and see if you can complete this. Let's see how you did. Please check over your work. We wanted harmonic intervals, so that's intervals that sound, notes, pitches that sound simultaneously. Both above and below the given note. and hopefully we did not change the given note. And I will slowly reveal the bottom answers, so you can check your work there as well. And which of these intervals below are tritones? Well, right here, the augmented fourth, and right here, the diminished fifth. So hopefully you did well with that review. Let's continue on. Now we're going to reduce compound intervals to their simple equivalent. Simple intervals. Simple intervals do not exceed an octave. Simple intervals include any interval with a quantity of prime or unison to 8. Compound intervals, on the other hand, are larger than an octave. Examples of compound intervals include ninths, tenths, elevenths, thirteenths. Compound and simple intervals have relationships. Each compound interval is related to a simple interval. Subtract 7 from the compound interval and you get the related simple interval. And it's really, no pun intended, that simple. Here's an example. 9 minus 7 equals 2. So that means that an interval of a ninth is related to a second. It's very important to note that a compound interval has the same quality as the related simple interval, because all we are doing is bringing the same pitch either up or down the octave. Occasionally, it is necessary to refer to compound intervals as ninths, tenths, elevenths, and so on, but often they are analyzed just as simple intervals. So here's an activity that we're going to do with the visual below. What we need to do is, number one, determine the name of each compound interval below. In other words, give me the generic number only. Number two, we'll subtract 7 from that generic number and determine the simple interval number. Number three, we'll notate the simple interval next to each compound one. And finally, number four, we can determine the quality of both the compound and simple interval. Recall that quality means, is it major? Is it minor? Is it diminished? Is it augmented? Or is it perfect? So in the first example, we've determined, number one, that the name of the compound interval is a 9. We subtracted 7 from 9 and determined that the simple interval is 2. Then we notated the simple interval next to the compound 1, and all we did was take the low C, the C4, and bring it up one octave to the C5. Lastly, we determined the quality of both the compound and simple interval, which are the same. So we have a major ninth reduced to a major second. 9 minus 7 is 2. So please take some time right now to complete the rest of these. Thank you. Okay, let's see how you did. So the first thing I'm going to do with each of these examples is bring the lower note up one octave and keep the top note as is. The next thing I'm going to do is figure out the generic number for both of these. So I'm going to start with the simple interval that I've already reduced. So here I have a 3, here I have a 4, a 5, a 6, a 7th, and an 8th. Now, in my mind, I reversed it. And I started with the simple interval. So instead of subtracting 7, I'm going to add 7. If I add 7 to the simple interval, that will determine the generic number for the compound interval. So 3 plus 7 is 10. That's a 10th. 4 plus 7 is 11. That's an 11th. 5 plus 7, that's a 12th. 6 plus 7 is a 13th. 7 plus 7 is a 14th. And 8 plus 7 is a 15th. Now I have the generic numbers for all of my intervals. Now I need to determine the quality for both of them. Well, I know that thirds, seconds, thirds, sixths, and sevenths are major or minor. I know that fourths and fifths and unisons or primes and octaves are perfect. So let's start with the simple interval. C to E, major third. Remember, the simple and compound interval have the same quality. So if I have a major third, the compound interval to that must also be major. So it's a major third and a major tenth. Fours are perfect. So the simple interval is a perfect fourth. Add 7 to that, and I come up with a perfect 11th. Fifths are perfect. Perfect fifth plus a seventh equals a perfect 12th. Sixths are major or minor. This happens to be major, C to A. So major sixth plus 7 is a major 13th. Sevenths are also major or minor, not perfect. So this is a major seventh. I have a C up to a B. Major 7 plus 7 is a major 14th for my compound interval. And in the last example here, eighths or octaves are perfect. So I have a P8 plus 7 is a perfect 15th. So college, if you are given a compound interval and are asked to reduce it to its simple interval equivalent, then you'll need to subtract 7. If you are given a simple interval and are asked to notate or determine the compound interval equivalent, then you'll need to add 7. Okay, so we're going to continue and do more practice with this. Here, what we need to do for these 5 examples, we need to name the pairs of compound and simple intervals and supply the quality for all intervals as well. So just like we did on the last page, we'll determine the generic number first, then determine if it's major or minor, or perfect, that's the quality. Keep in mind that the quality will remain the same for all 5 examples because what we're doing is just simply realizing the compound and simple equivalent to each interval. So take a moment to complete this, college. Good luck. Thank you. so let's see how you did with this, college. So for number one, we should have come up with a major ninth and a major second. For number two, we have a P11 and a P4. For number three, we have a major 13th and a major 6th. For number four, we have a major 10th and a major 3rd. Number five, we have a P12 and a P5. Now you notice that in number one, rather than taking the low note and bringing it up an octave, we took the higher note and we brought it down an octave. The result is the same. The same thing happens in number two, where we took the F, the upper note, and lowered it an octave. In every case, you get the number 7 when you subtract the generic number of the compound interval with that of the generic number of the simple interval. Okay, college, it's time for a game called Lucky 13. You have only 1 minute to circle all compound intervals out of the 51 examples below. And you should have a piece of paper with all 51 intervals on it. Okay, ready? Begin. That was more like 30 seconds. Let's see how you did. You only needed to circle 13 compound intervals. Remember, compound intervals exceed an octave. And let's see how you did with our lucky 13 answer key. Okay, college, we're going to do some class practice now with our intervals. You're going to see the same 51 intervals that you saw in the Lucky 13 game that we just played. But now, let's read the directions carefully. It says, identify each simple and compound harmonic interval. In other words, the specific name and quality is what you'll need to provide. For example, minor third, major sixth, perfect fourth. For the 13 compound intervals that you circled and located in the Lucky 13 game, you'll also need to provide the simple interval equivalent for those 13. Okay, now I want to take a look at one of those compound intervals, for example. I want to take a look at number 35. We can look at that one right here. I'll circle it. All right, so let's take this example, and if we raise the lower note up one octave, that's a low E. If we raise it up one octave, we find that it's still, the distance still exceeds an octave. So it's actually still a compound interval. So we can take that E and raise it up yet another octave like that. Now we've determined that the simple interval is that of a third. It happens to be a major third because we're dealing with an E to a G sharp. So that's a major third. But this big interval, we had to bring up the octave twice. So it's going to have to be 3 plus 7 plus 7. which actually means that this is a major 17th. Hopefully that makes some sense. And if you actually were to count from this low E all the way up to this G sharp, you would find 17. Okay, so that was a little bit tricky. I helped you out with that one. So I'm going to give you some time to complete this. Again, let's read the directions. Identify each simple and compound harmonic interval. So name and quality. For the 13 compound intervals, you'll need to provide two answers. The simple interval equivalent and what's actually written, the compound interval. Remember that the quality of simple and compound pairs stay the same. And note that all of these intervals might not necessarily be major. So good luck, college. Use the rest of class time to complete this. We'll see how you do. Thank you. Okay, college, at this point, you should be finished with all 51 intervals. If you're not, that's okay. But if you got up to maybe number 40, that would be acceptable. Let's check over our work. Notice the intervals that I have marked in red are the compound intervals from the Lucky 13 game that we played earlier and require two answers. So check over your work and see how you did. Thanks so much for watching, college. Make it a great day.